validated by the Grand complex, and if one has a differential form and writes it in terms of holomorphic and anti-holomorphic coordinates, then PQ means that you have P holomorphic differentials and Q anti-holomorphic differentials. But there is a slightly different point of view. Let me mention that. I mean, it's from the point of view of proof. It's exactly what I said, that the fact that it is projective, or more generally Qaisar, means that any differential form can be, closed differential form can be written as a sum of closed forms of this type, modulo exact forms. But the, let's say, the cohomology of C, well, C as a sheaf, if one thinks in terms of the derived category, is also the holomorphic Grand complex. And the holomorphic Grand complex is filtered, and from that one gets a filtration of the cohomology. And since there is a real structure, one automatically gets two filtrations, and then those two filtrations determine the Hodge decomposition. Although the proof uses what I said before. Yes, and I should mention that this decomposition used by definition satisfies this complex conjugate in our condition. So, well, there is more structure. Namely, I want to look at S. Ah, yes. So, yeah. equal to multiplication by n minus k on Hk. And then it turns out that, yes, let me give a name to this operator, let me call it P. And then it turns out that if one calculates commutators, one gets these relations. Different from LS. is equal to Rx and U is equal to V. Or another way to say that is there is a Hermitian form with respect to which the Hodge decomposition is orthogonal. And then the sign of the form on the various Hodge pieces, since this is e to the p minus q, so when you increase p by 1, then q decreases by 1, and you have a change of sign by minus 1. So this form has alternating signs on successive pieces. So, and of course what I should point out is that primitive cohomology and its Hodge decomposition completely determines the Hodge decomposition. And a Hermitian form. Well, let me say it very quickly. So, Hermitian form and the different Hodge pieces are perpendicular, but with alternating signs. So, I mean, this is, so if one takes all of this together, this is the so-called Hodge package. And what is actually curious is that in one place where all of this is described very efficiently and smoothly, well, maybe I shouldn't say efficiently, is André Weil's book, Varietät Galerienne. But in his account, there is something very, very curious. Namely, he never tells you that these three operators span a copy of SL2. And so what he really does, without ever saying it, is he proves that finite dimensional representations of SL2 are completely reducible, and how you can write them down in the standard bases, and what the Pioneer forms do. So he does the representation theory of SL2 without ever telling you. And, well, I mean, I think it's very safe to assume that André Weil knew this. I mean, it's hard to imagine he did not. But then I would think it's remarkable that he fails to tell me. All right, so this is the Hodge decomposition for the cohomology of a projective variety. And so now, let me do this with parameters. So I want to look at V over T, P, so a family of smooth polarized complex projective varieties. Parameterized by T, which is a complex manifold, or maybe typically it would be an algebraic, but for the definition that does not matter. So what do I mean? So V is a complex manifold, P is holomorphic, surjective, of maximum length. If I look at the fiber over T, this is smooth complex projective and polarized. So what do I mean by polarized? So of course each fiber is polarized, but they're supposed to fit together. But I mean, the polarization is, for example, is integral, even though I didn't say that applies in the integral cohomology, so it applies in lattice. So for the polarization, this is molded in a puff. Now, if you have the situation with a smooth, suggestive mat of maximal rime, compact fibers, then molded is a product. And so what this means is that you get flat vector bundles. Let me call them HK from. Vector bundles over T with fiber, the typical fiber, well, the homology to BK of B sub T, complex coefficients and Bremen. So, in the C infinity category, this is a product. So, locally, all the fibers look the same. And this local trivialization is unique up to a continuous family, a differentiable family of diffeomorphisms of the fiber. But that does not act contrivially on the cohomology. So these bundles are flat. And so what do we have? So with a flat polarization class, C sub T, so for each T one has C sub T, but it's flat in terms of the flat structure. And intersection pairing, S for each T on the fiber, and C infinity sub bundles. H to Q sub T, then the H to Q dt C sub primitive. So there's C infinity, and we are in a holomorphic context. So, you hope that there's something holomorphic, but in the naive sense, this cannot be the case because when Q is not zero, there are anti-holomorphic pieces. So what one has to do is look at F sub T, P, which by definition is the direct sum of H L minus L V sub T C primitive. With L greater than or equal to P. So these are holomorphic. And if one looks at the as, well, I mean, the FP encodes the Hodge decomposition because the primitive PQ cohomology is the intersection of FP and FQ complex conjugate. So this determines the HPQ subcomponent. It looks like less information, but it carries the entire information. And then, of course, one has the polarization condition that tied to the P plus Q to minus Q S sub T satisfies those conditions. Okay, so that, I mean, what happens here is one looks not just at the Keller package of Hodge, Lefschetz package of a single projective variety, but one looks at how it varies when the variety depends on parameter. That's what this formalizes. And so why would one do that? Well, let's say the classical Torelli theorem for curves says that the Hodge decomposition completely determines the Riemann surface. So if you look at Riemann surfaces, well, there's a topological invariant, the genus, and then if you fix the genus, look at all projective curves of that genus, they are determined up to automorphism by the Hodge decomposition. And to call this a hope is an overstatement, but the idea was that, well, I mean, at least in certain cases, these Hodge decompositions should also determine what's called the moduli of the typical fiber. And that, as examples show, that is really extending too much. But nonetheless, as one lets the parameter vary and sees how the Hodge decomposition varies, it does give some information about the geometry of the family. And so let me, what I'm going to say next is going to be very vague, very vague. But let's say I, in the early 70s, and companion Kaplan Schmidt in the 80s, these were very precise descriptions of the potential similarities of, of, let's say, the B of B sub T. And I mean, what does that mean? Well, if you look at families of the sort, let's say in the algebraic set, so families of smooth projective varieties, almost always, if you look at any example, what you expect is that in this family, if you compete it, if you want the base space to be complete, projective, then almost always you will have some singular fibers. And so, of course, this picture does not extend to the singular fibers, at least not a priori. And so the question is, what happens to the Hodge decomposition as a typical generic smooth fiber degenerates into a singular fiber? And this was done in the case when the parameter space is one-dimensional, and that for a higher dimension. And of course, when you describe the singularities, then you are free to blow up, let's say, the completion of T along the singular locus, and so you can assume without essential loss of generality that in the one-dimensional case T is a function of disks, and in the high-dimensional case it's a product of function of disks. And so these papers describe the similarities of the Hodge flags quite precisely. And what is curious is that let's say, when this that these geometric arguments, which were in fact done a few years later, they give you no more. So everything that you can try to say geometrically, and actually is more difficult, I mean, it's more bothersome to prove in the geometric setting, everything follows from these results, which do not assume that the family completes. So what this suggests, of course, is that when you have a quasi-projective T, is that in some moral sense, even if the family is not given to you as something complete, in a moral sense, of course, there's some way in which you can complete it. So the limiting behavior of a Hodge structure looks as if, yes, it comes from geometry. And in some sense, it does. And so to prove what happens as the general fiber degenerates, well, one can do this by just looking at this abstract setting. So, yes, I mean, I should. And maybe what I said here is slightly premature. This statement premature in the lecture, because what I should say
excuse me, just a general question. T is quasi projective, is V quasi projective?
Well, I mean, you don't have to assume it to prove it.
Okay? I don't know what that means.
Well, so actually, as I just said, I mean, the statement was slightly premature. And so you will see in a moment what the answer to your question is. Yes, so there is some level of abstraction. So first of all, suppose V is a finite dimensional complex vector space and finite over Q. I mean, finite over Q simply means that there is a finite-dimensional rational vector space, and this is its complexification. It's its tensor product of that rational vector space that we will see. And then we suppose that S minus K is an integer, and S from V to cross V to C, a non-degenerate symmetric if k is even and skew if s is odd. So then a Hodge structure of weight k and b polarized decomposition of V to go to the direct sum of V to Q, P and Q adding up to K with V to P complex conjugate to V to Q plus I to the P minus Q S of write it down, this is the previous condition. Namely that if I take I to the P minus Q S of E, this is then a Hermitian form, and the decomposition is orthogonal with respect to it, and it's positive definite, meaning that on VPQ, So that is the definition of an abstract polarized Hodge structure. And then suppose now we have, let's say, V over T, a flat vector bundle. With flat rational structure and flat bilinear form S, then one gets the notion of a polarized variation of Hodge structure. So I won't write down the formal definition because in some sense I have already. So instead of looking at the individual pieces, PQ, you take the direct sum for, let's say, P greater than or equal to some particular P naught. Those things then have to vary homomorphically with respect to the base parameter. And again, one has surface transfer sum. So, so what is that? Is then imposed as an axiom. And so then what we have over there is a particular case of one of these abstract variations of Hodge structure. And so of course the statements that I made about singularities, they can be proved, were proved, in this setting, even if it doesn't come from geometry, for arbitrary variations of Hodge structure. Right, so that, I think, then answers your question. So there's no reason for the proof to assume the family of the original family is projective, justified as
something. But you didn't make any precise statements about the
singular
question.
It is a precise description.
Right.
And to tell you what that is, I would have to define the period map.
Yeah.
And then in terms of the period map, I mean, there's a so-called no-potent orbit theorem, there's a two-orbit theorem, and they give you, you know, what can I say? They give you very precise information.
Okay. So you're saying that this can now be done in this
abstract? Well, in fact, not just can be, it was done that way. Yeah. Right? I mean, the original proofs were in that setting. And then later, there were geometric proofs when the variation comes from the family, a family which where the family is completed. But you don't get any more information that way than you get by just assuming, by just considering as an abstract variation of Hodge structure.
Okay, now I understand better what you meant with
yes.
This.
Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay, so now, I cannot be completely explicit in what I'm saying next, what I'm going to say next, although I think it should be clear enough. Then there is a slight extension. One does not need to assume the existence of a rational or even real structure. Now, so in the definition of an abstract Hodge structure or a variation of Hodge structure, but I mean, let me warn you, of course, that one has to say things slightly differently. Because here one has this decomposition, and then the S imposes these orthogonality and positivity conditions. So in this setting, instead of looking at the individual DPQs, one looks at the filtration. So to get the translation from here to there, you don't look at the DPQs, but the filtration, namely taking FP, which is the direct sum of VL, K minus L for L greater than or equal to P. So the complex Hodge structure would be characterized by this filtration, and then the form S is part of what you need to make sense out of this, because then you get the second filtration by taking the orthogonal complement, by taking the orthogonal complements. And so then by having the flags, the S, you get the second filtration, and they're supposed to be related so that you then reconstruct the PPQ as the intersection of FP with the appropriate orthogonal complement. And then V should be the direct sum of these, and again, you should have this condition. So to write this down would take longer than it's worth, but the point is that one can make sense out of this definition, a slight modification, without assuming that there's a rational structure. And then the same is true for the notion of a variation of Hodge structure. Again, one can say things, one has to say them somewhat differently, but one can say things without assuming that there's a rational structure. So that's going to be important for what I'm going to say later. So that means that one has the notion of a complex polarized Hodge structure, and the notion of a complex polarized variation of Hodge structure. Over the sheaf of algebras, So then there are two important notions. Ah, yes, first I should say, so these encode linear differential equations. And rather than making this precise, I'll give you a simple example in just a moment. So there are then two important notions, namely, simple example. So now T is C. So C is affine, and if one has, let's say, sheaves in the algebraic sense, sheaves over an affine variety, well, over an affine variety, to know the sheaf is the same as knowing its global section. And so the global sections of B in this setting would be polynomials in Z and P by Z. Now, so polynomials, but of course these two quantities do not commute. They behave in the usual way. I mean, dz, I mean the commutator is one. And so the example I have in mind is take M, which is D. Mod D is dz. So the system of differential equations that encodes is z f dz is f, or the solution is log z. And log z, I mean the differential equation that gives you log z has regular singular points. And it is sufficiently determined. I mean, an example of something that is not sufficiently determined is that you look at functions of two variables, u and v, and you just say df dv, df by du is zero, but make no mention of what v does. And that's not sufficiently determined. Okay, so one has this notion. And so regular polynomial D modules are closed under the standard operations. On the level of the derived category, namely, if F is an algebraic map, then one has direct image, inverse image, direct image with proper supports, inverse image with proper supports, and Bernier-Duhem. So all of these can be defined in the setting. And then there is the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence from the bounded derived category of regular polynomial E modules to the bounded derived category of constructible sheaves. So now it's constructible sheaves of complex vector spaces. So this is the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, and it is an equivalence of categories. So RH stands for Riemann-Hilbert. And then, of course, this statement is to be understood in the following sense. On sheaves of vector spaces, at least at the derived level, one has these operations. This equivalence of categories relates the operations on this side to the corresponding operations on that side. So in the setting of abstract structures, maybe constructs. So in the complex setting, what does one have? One has a vector space V and a Hodge filtration. So since I allow the complex case, I'm not looking at the VPQ, but at the FP, and that is the polarization form. So in the setting, in this setting, a more general notion is a mixed Hodge structure, is a polarized mixed Hodge structure. Namely, two filtrations now, one has B, FP, and W sub K, and still in S. So, where this, so first of all, as a general notational convention, if the index for filtration is at the top, that means decreasing. If it's at the bottom, it means increasing. So this now is increasing, and it's defined over Q when there is a rational structure. And then the condition is that the F dot induces polarized Hodge structure of weight K on WK mod WK minus 1 for each K. So the mixed Hodge structure, as I say, there are these two filtrations, and on the level, so W is the weight filtration. This is the Hodge location. And let's take the what the delta function at the origin generates when you apply B. That is not over here. So, but so this is supposed to be a filtration by all coherent all submodules, such that when you apply D1, meaning differential operators of degree 1 or less, to Fp of M, and this sits in inside Fp plus 1 of M, and this is equal for P sufficiently big. So that's the notion of a good filtration. And you notice that these filtrations are increasing before the Hodge filtrations were decreasing. But the reason is, the reason why they're increasing is because you could make them decreasing easily enough by defining F upper P to be F minus P at the bottom. But then the indices would be negative. So in the context of E modules, to get positive indices, one should make the filtration increasing. But one can always go back and forth between increasing and decreasing filtrations. It's just here to get negative integers. It's just better to make an increase. Does that make sense? Slightly over time to get I need another minute or so. So then cycle filter models. So what I looked at here is data two, but of course not all of them, just some of them, with two filtrations. Well, filtered of course means I already have a filtration, and filtration F, with a finite increasing filtration by regular polynomial in submodels of the M, such that the F dot such that, so now various requirements.
What's DR?
Pardon?
DR.
Duran. Remember, enough. Duran is another way of saying. Such that, first of all, so these are closed under the standard operations. So I won't repeat them. And again, of course, these are D-module operations now. I mean, to come back to what you said before. I mean, they're not defined the same way, but the ones that correspond to the standard operations under Riemann-Hogarth. So closed under the standard operations, it contains all polarized variations of Hodge structure. Because if you have a polarized variation of Hodge structure, you can look at the sheaf of holomorphic or algebraic sections of that flat bundle. And locally, you have a filtration. And so that is a good filtration, because the quotients are finite dimensional, and the level of vector bundles finite dimensional vector bundles. So the sections would be coherent to call. So when you have a variation of Hodge structure, then you do get a filtered D module, and it's supposed to be in this category. And then Schwing, if you look at the category of mixed Hodge modules for the point, this is the category of polarized mixed Hodge modules. Okay. Yeah, so now there is quite a bit to be said. So first of all, I mean, how should one view this? So, it's the smallest category that satisfies these conditions. So then, that's a definition which, of course, depends on the theorem that it exists.
Yeah, just thinking, just trying to understand this.
Well, I will say, of course, more, then maybe you should ask the question later. Well, I mean, because I'm about to explain something. So how should one view this? defined statement. Nonetheless, it's like this, that this gives you mixed launch structures on just about anything where you have any reason to suspect that there is a mixed launch structure. And when there are mixed launch structures coming from geometric considerations, then it's not always obvious that they're the same ones, but in cases when it's been done, they are. So this is a perfectly general construction, and it really puts Hodge structures, mixed Hodge structures on anything where you have any right to expect this. Now, so this consists, I mean, the proof consists of a large number of papers, and they are thoroughly written. So, you know, I mean, in paper 5, there may be a statement that, well, we use the results of paper 4, except that we now use this notation, that notation. I mean, they are almost impenetrable. And so this was proved in the, I mean, this goes back to the 80s, late 80s, early 90s. And, I mean, I think to this day, there are some people who still have some doubt that there's actually complete proof. But, I mean, there is, many people, of course, do think that there is enough evidence of consistency that it's inconceivable that this is not correct. And then, you know, one thing which is relevant for where I'm going to end up is that, I mean, the arguments are very intricate, they are very tricky, but they are, for the most part, they are fairly formal. They are arguments with, you know, which involve p-modules, but there is one, let's say, basic analytic ingredient, and this is the description of the potential singularities of variations of Hodge structures. So that is the basic analytic ingredient. And so there are some attempts now to rewrite the story coherently. And then there is a different point of view, which I will describe now. So, why should one care and why So by dispensing with the rational structure, you're not really losing anything, because if there is a rational structure, just put it in. And then it makes sense of the category of filtered regular holonormic D models. You just shouldn't look at all of them, just at the ones that you can generate by this procedure. And so then, why should this be, or why is it correct? So the, I mean, these so-called orbit-orbit theorems that I alluded to before, by, you know, in the 70s and 80s, they were proved under the assumption that it's a rational structure. But then, you know, almost immediately after the first paper came out, Delinia pointed out that, you know, you don't really need the rational structure. So the rational structure, what it means is that around, let's say, the visors, the monochromy has eigenvalues that are roots of one. And if you forget about the rational structure, then all you have is that there are eigenvalues of absolute value 1. But that suffices. So, I mean, if you look at the proofs, you know, you have to just say, you know, a few additional pages, and then this is true in that context. And since that is the basic analytic input, it's virtually certain that the result holds in this degree of generality. And in fact, there are some people now that are trying to write it, write down details in that context. And so why is this relevant for my lectures? It's because I want to apply it in this context. So when I talk about representations, this is what we have. We don't have rational structure. Of course, if one is really worried about the details, one can reduce it to the case that there is a rational structure, but that is an ugly artificial process. So it's much more natural to work in this context, and surely it's correct. But, you know, for our purpose, it's not absolutely necessary. But not to use it in this degree of generality would be really, really bad. Okay? Yeah, I'm sorry that I went over time, but
we were talking to Yvonne. This is, I think, very interesting and very important for many of us. It would be an idea to start a half an hour early tomorrow. And then you would have an opportunity to give two shorter lectures. Would that, you see, like, it's too tiring for you?
No, I think
you're getting a little bit old, son.
No, I think that so this lecture had to be one lecture, right? I mean, or else, you know, to resume this.
No, but we could have a review tomorrow, because then we'll have to ask a few questions, and if you don't mind, well, if it's not tiring.
Well, I mean, I'd rather not make this two lectures tomorrow.
Ask me some, not long, actually.
Tomorrow, no, ask me some questions tomorrow or right now.
Okay, okay.
So, very good suggestion.
Yeah.
So, are these categories abelian categories?
No.
What's the usual problem with filtered objects?
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, if you look at the arguments, it's, you know, there are, you know, sometimes 4 or 5 filtrations, and they have to be compatible. I mean, it's a zoo.
Okay. Well, I wanted to ask you to review the definition there, because I was looking at it, and I'm not sure I understand.
Maybe.
Sorry. Object. Regular holonomic filter. Now, the word filtered there
means given with, equipped with a particular group filtration.
Right, which means that then you can maybe cross it out, because of the next line it says with a finite.
No.
That's the problem.
So there is a second filtration.
Yeah, and I was not very clear how what the port says makes.
Finite increasing weight filtration.
Ah, okay.
Sorry. Yes, sorry.
Because this was like a puzzle, wasn't it?
Filtration W.
W.
Ruhr is a filtration by Demon.
So we could, so the F comes in the first line, so regular polynomial module with a good filtration F,
yes,
right? With an additional filtration W,
yes,
which is now a D-module filtration,
yes,
in the sense that
it's and D-module. And good as well.
Yeah, do we know a finite infinite W?
No, that W is a finite.
W is finite.
Wave filtration is always finite.
Okay, the first is
it's defined over Q whenever there is a Q.
Right, the first is infinite a priori.
Well, I mean, sometimes it's finite.
Right, a priori is infinite. And then, let me try to tell us, F, such that the good filtration induces good filtrations
on
each quotient of the other one.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Okay. Now it makes sense. But
so I mean, we have
set W there.
What you have now, I mean, there are several things I did not say. I mean, they're not necessary to make sense out of the statements. So, for example, I mean, what is very relevant in applications is that on the graded level.
Yeah.
So I mean, the F induces filtration always on the graded levels. But what you get on the graded levels is semi-symmetry.
Oh, as what?
As a demon.
As a demon, semi-simple as a demon.
Semi-simple as a demon.
That's an assumption.
No, it's a theorem. I mean, that is part of the construction. It's part of the construction. So, I mean, it's not a theorem in the sense that, it's part of the construction.
Oh, and you didn't say, I agree, on what's the base variety on which this whole thing is formed?
Any smooth quasi-projective variety.
So what are nice examples when x is not a point? Let's say on P1 or
I gave you an example, right?
Yes.
So this was d by dz.
That's right.
D by dz. And so what is that? I mean, on c star, it's just O. At the origin, what you get is potential singular. I mean, you get the delta function, what's generated by the delta function by d.
Okay.
So you get negative part. So that, I mean, when it clearly belongs to this category. And so the wave filtration means that at weight zero, you get just things that don't have singularities at the origin. And then weight one gives you the delta.
So the wave filtration on this thing is just two?
Yes.
I see.
So I and in
fact, so the D module is so let's use this. So the D module is as it was, it's just a D module. Then you say we have a clear enough good filtration on it.
Yes.
Now we have to think about a second filtration, and that just has two terms.
Yes.
So that's what you're saying.
And the good filtration, of course, is simply by order of singularity.
Yeah.
I mean negative power.
Okay. This helps? So I just want to take more time to do this.
Okay, so I guess we're not going to
Well, no, if we could take
it from your over, that's fine.
Just one. So, does one ever do any kind of homological algebra in this category?
Well, proof is, or let's say, a very, very heavy dose of homological algebra.
Some sort of non-Abelian homological
algebra. Yeah, no, just. Look at some of his papers.
Well, I'll take your word for it.
I mean, it'll drive you to despair.
Where is he now, Saxon?
Well, he is at the University of Hessen, at the University of York.
The University.
So, I mean, it's a strange case. I mean, I think he is mathematically autistic. I mean, I don't think he is clinically autistic, but he is mathematically autistic. I mean, you cannot ask him a question and expect a reasonable answer.
not all my most difficult.
No. No, I mean, so, look, I mean, this is a major, major accomplishment. I mean, why isn't he at Rennes?
I remember that this theory was used to give an ultimate proof of the decomposition theorem.
Of course. Well, actually, if you, so what is perfectly clear, if you read his first paper, is what I'm going to do is to give a proof of the decomposition theorem that doesn't depend on finite characteristic going down to the and of course, it's a more general statement of the decomposition theorem, of course. And especially if you don't require the rational structure. But, I mean, then, of course, you have a more general decomposition theorem. But of course, now there exists an even more general decomposition theorem. Because you don't need the regular singular form.
I do prove that.
How much is it be?
Oh.
But hasn't the being believed that is?
No, I mean, he has, to the extent one can say, he's validated.
That is validated, but he's I know that this is.
No, but then now there are young people in Hodge theory
who are
energetic and who say this is.